Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Brother Sean, for playing that song. It's in my heart.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Eternal God, our Father, once more and again, a few of your children have gathered themselves together in this place. Another Sunday, God, has come, and we have come to hear the word. So, God, we ask you to move us all out of the way, that we see nor hear none of ourselves, but all of you. Speak, Holy Spirit. Speak with clarity.
Yes.
Speak bold if you have to within our minds.
Yes.
Touch our hearts today, God, and let us realize that every day we wake up is a gift.
Oh, yes. Yes,
and tomorrow is not promised. So we must live today,
yes,
as if today,
yes,
is our last. Amen. Remind us, dear Lord, that none of us came here to stay. Some may linger on a little longer than others, but there is one thing that you have said, and to every life, death shall come. We all have to die and leave this world, and we need to be working upon our soul salvation. We bind up every spirit that's not of you who declare and teach us or make us think that we have time to keep doing what we're doing. But today your word will speak loud, that we will understand that we have to be about our Father's business. So we thank you today. Preach, Holy Spirit, that we may hear what thus say the Lord. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of these words, and may it sink deep down within our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the grateful say amen.
Amen.
Let the saved say amen.
Amen.
And let the thankful,
yes,
say amen.
Amen.
Praises and glory unto God, who is the author and finisher of all of our faith.
Yes.
And then turn with me quickly to the book of Matthew, the 7th chapter. I'm not going to try to be before you too long. The book of Matthew, the 7th chapter. And we're going to start at the 24th verse. Matthew, the 7th chapter. Start at the 24th verse. First of all, we do give honor to God, who is the author and finisher of our faith. We give honor to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
We give honor to Elder Wimberly this morning. Amen. And Elder Reed. This morning, we give honor to both of them. It's not easy accepting a call and then walking in that light. Amen.
Amen.
Give honor to our deacons this morning, Deacon Cedric and his lovely wife, Deaconess Annie Cedric. Amen. We give honor to our deacons of our church, and give honor to missionary Ruth Ford, amen. Give honor to her.
Amen.
And then most of all, I would be foolish to be remiss and not give honor to my wife on this morning, to our leading lady, amen, First Lady Porter. We give honor to her on this morning as well. And then to all of you, our brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, we give honor to you all as well.
Amen.
Amen. Our scripture will read as so. Therefore, whosoever hear these sayings of mine and doeth them. I will liken him unto a wise man, which built his house upon a rock, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and built and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And everyone that heard these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man, which built his house upon the sand, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. Amen. And it came to pass, when Jesus had ended these sayings, the people were astonished at his doctrine, for he had taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. Amen. And may it sink deep down in his heart. You may be seated. Our subject this morning is wise men still seek him. Wise men still seek him. The author and the profile of this text on this morning is Matthew, Brother Matthew, Apostle Matthew, also known as Saint Matthew and Levi, was one of the 12 disciples of Jesus Christ. He is traditionally regarded as the author of the Gospel of Matthew. Amen. When Jesus called Matthew to follow him, he was a tax collector, publican, one of the most revered professions in the ancient Jerusalem during that time. Our nutshell in this text this morning is Matthew challenges his readers to choose between obedience, or should I say obeying the will of God, and disobeying the will of God. There ain't but one or two things. There ain't no middle. Either you hot, are you cold? Either you right or you wrong. Either you gonna be obedient or disobedient. Amen. For the believers, this involves humility, yes, self-examination, and dependence on him. Who? Who's him? Jesus, for everything. If we're going to be obedient and do what the will of God is asking us to do, it's going to involve humility. Amen. Meaning that there's going to be times in your life you're going to have to humble yourself. Okay, a proud look, proud. Bible talks about God hate proud, prideful people. You know, some of us, let's be real, not some of us, all of us, when we're in the world, we had to walk prideful. Yes, you did. Don't need to stop lying. You come into church and you try to bring the same worldly stuff into the church. Some of y'all in here right now, saved, sanctified, and filled, and still proud. You know, still got that pride. You know, still, you know, got that bulliness in you. Mm-hmm. Still got that stubbornness in you. Yeah, yeah, yeah. All that stuff we supposed to have in the world, in the streets. That's how we rolled in the street. Anybody roll up on you, they don't know me. I give. You don't supposed to be in the church acting and talking like that. You're supposed to be born again. You're supposed to be changed from those old ways of doing things. You're supposed to be humble. Amen. You supposed. He said, if somebody slap you in your face, turn to give them the other cheek. That takes humility to do that. You're not going to, he said, love our enemies. You ain't ain't gonna have no worldly mind, no prideful flesh mind, and you loving your enemies. I want you to check yourself today. Whoever I'm talking to, you need to check your spirit. You gotta be doing this while you're on this earth. Don't wait till you die and try to get it right. You need to be working on it right now. Stop walking around telling people, this just who I am. I ain't there yet, Pastor. I know you're not. I know you're not, and guess what? God knows you're not. Yeah, we coming down the street today because God wants us to understand, stop walking around letting the devil fool you and stop walking around lying to yourself. There is a way that seem right unto man. That's the way I'm talking about. You come into church, still I got that same old spirit. It seem right to you. But to God, you ain't changed. You know, you can't be saved and unsaved at the same time. You can't be godly and then worldly at the same time. You can't love Jesus and love Satan at the same time. You can't be out here hanging out with the devil on Saturday, coming to church praising God on Sunday. You can't be out here at the club doing the butt and all this stuff, shaking. You know the new dances y'all got out here. You drinking liquor, dropping them like that, you know what I'm saying? Smoking your little trees, you know, where you smoking stuff that you ain't really in your right mind. You what they call it? You blazed out, amen. You got glazed eyes, you looking around all crazy. See, when you in that spirit, you don't know what you gonna say. You don't know how you gonna treat. Sometimes y'all wake up on some mornings and be like, man, what did I do last night? Where was I at last night? What was going on in my head? Because you done sat there and got drunk, then cool it brown, smoking that little tree where you don't know if you coming or going. You don't know what you saying to somebody. See, we're supposed to be in the world, but not of. I feel like preaching this morning. I don't know who showed up, but guess what? You here now. Amen. So for the believers, that's us. This involves humility. Humility. I don't know who I'm talking to. Let's be real. But this here, this walk that God is talking about, we have to be humble. We got to carry ourselves in a humble way. You know why, y'all? Because the world is watching. Everything we do. Sometimes y'all want to be real. If I have to do it to myself, I'll give myself high five. Sometimes the Christians, our brothers and sisters, they waiting to call you out. Yeah. You ain't got to worry about the world calling y'all. The ones who supposed to be praying with us, praying for us, understanding, coming to you, pulling you to the side, letting you know your slip is showing, you know, should be pulling you to the side, letting you know, bro, you walking in a different character. Them the ones that would be talking about you, boning their friends. Yeah, they said they saved. They post, but don't you supposed to be saved too? You can't be saved and you're supposed to have a spirit of humility and you run around here gossiping and running folk down and you're supposed to be saved too. Am I my brother's keeper?
That's the word.
Mighty quiet in here. Am I my brother's keeper? Where you think they got that from? That means you're supposed to see your brother in a bad state and you're supposed to come and not, oh, I thank God for Jesus. I don't know who I'm talking to. Don't y'all thank God for Jesus?
Yes.
That he see our stuff and he'll cover us.
Yes.
He's not like our brothers in the church. Jesus ain't like he. I thank God that Jesus ain't walking around saying, I ain't there yet. I'm glad he there. Because Jesus will cover us. Then he won't call you out. Huh? Won't remind you of your junk like some of us do. You can't, it's hard to go to your friends and tell them your problems and won't. Is there anybody today you can lean on?
That's right.
I'm just talking. I mean, we just having a conversation. I'm gonna preach. Is there anybody we can lean on in the time of trouble? I mean, I know we can lean on Jesus, but I'm talking about in the church. We're supposed to be living a life, my brothers and sisters. We, not you. We supposed to be living a life that we should be able to lean on each other. That folks see you out there, they should be able to cover you and bring you in. And yeah, let me preach this sermon. Amen. Self-examination.
Self-examination.
God don't want us to walk around just doing anything.
Yeah.
We supposed to have self-examination.
Yes.
Meaning every day of our life we ought to get up today.
Amen.
And we ought to thank God that we didn't the last night on our cooler bed.
Amen.
We ought to wake up this morning with a new spirit and we ought to be having a self examination.
Amen.
Now I ain't say examine your neighbor.
No.
I didn't say that. See, that's what we do.
Yes.
See, we do what we don't supposed to do.
Yes.
Always doing what we don't supposed to do, but never doing what we supposed to do.
Yes.
Bible never said examine your brother.
Yeah.
Examine your sister. He said, examine yourself.
Yeah.
We supposed to right now, as the word is being taught, we should be in a self examination right now. That's why you came to church this morning. You should have came in here to hear the word and do a self examination.
Right.
Can I preach for a little while?
Yeah.
Who goes to the doctor to see what's wrong with me?
Uh-huh.
And then talk about you. Doctor tell me, Mr. Porter, you need to stop drinking sugar drinks.
Well.
Leave dark sodas alone. Stop drinking Monsters.
Uh-huh.
Stop drinking these fruit drinks.
Well.
You need more water in your diet.
That's right.
He talking to me. I go home and First Lady drinking a Pepsi, and ain't this what we do? Come on, y'all might as well be real, huh? I heard what he said to me, but I'll go home and lose what he said to me and start examining her. Drill, you don't need to be drinking dark sodas. He didn't say that to her. Yeah. I'm trying to get her right. Ain't that what I preached last Sunday? Stop worrying about the log that's in my eye. Trying to see the splendor in hers. Yeah, that's what we do now. We worry about other folk because we're not doing a self
examination.
I'm not going to be for y'all long. I'm going to preach. I'm going to get out your way. Here's something else we do. Church folk. Right? Church folk. Yeah, this is something else we do. We will come to church on first Sunday. I'm not talking about True Heart. I'm talking about Christians all over the world. This is what we do. We examine ourselves on communion Sunday. Yeah. Catholic, I don't care what denomination you are, we're all the same. They go up there, do a Hail Mary, bam, Father Christ, whatever they say, and they stand in front of this altar and they doing a self-examination. And these things normally last for a minute. Okay, I'm not talking about Catholic. We do the same in the Baptist, non-denominational. I don't care what religion you under, whatever religion you claim, whatever set, whatever your set is, Hoover Deuce, Bloods, Crips, whatever your set, you know, they do that in the world. In the church, we the same. You know, we got gangs, Baptist, Catholic, Protestant, what set you under? I'm Church of God in Christ. We better than all y'all. I'm Baptist. We're more preservative. I'm non-denominational. I don't get caught up in none of that. It's not like a bunch of gangs. A bunch of cliques. Yeah. Why don't we just be Christ-like? Why don't we all just examine ourselves to be Christ-like? Forget about denominations. Let's be Christ-like. Amen. You got all these denominations. I'm going to get in trouble. I know I'm going to get in trouble. It's going to go in the air. Somebody's going to hear it, but that's all right. I don't care. I'm preaching the gospel. We got all of these different denominations, right? But ain't nobody master love. and master, love your neighbor as you love yourself. That ain't no denomination. That's Christ. On these laws hang all the laws of prophets. Amen. Love thy God. What denomination got to do with loving your God with all your heart? All your soul and all your mind. God is saying, this is the denomination I need. I need y'all to stop being caught up in all these different denominations and get caught up in the Word of God.
Amen.
Stop looking at color.
I know that's right. Come on, Bishop.
Come on,
Bishop. Amen.
You saved, but you don't get along with Mexicans. You saved, but you don't get along with Caucasians. You saved, but you look at the news and look at all this garbage that's being thrown out there. You saved, but you don't like homosexuals. If you saved and you got the love of God, it don't matter what they are, because my issue is not them. My issue is me. God told me to love everybody, treat everybody right. Stop worrying about this person and that person. Who murdered this person and who you? It ain't for you to talk about who murdered who. Just worry about who you murdered to.
Yeah.
Caught up in worrying about. I don't want my black sons to bring home white daughter-in-law. Who cares? If they happy and they love them, bring them home. What's wrong with us now? You worrying about trying to save the world, can't save yourself. I told y'all I'm gonna get in trouble. Y'all go to True Heart, hold me down. Tell them that the pastor was preaching, he was in the day of the Spirit of the Lord. Yeah. They gonna talk about me. They gonna run me down, but it's all right. Y'all pray for me. Anybody looking and listening, pray for me. I can't help it. I gotta preach in season, out of season. When they wanna hear me, and when they don't. Pastor, gonna break this sermon down. I'm going home. I'm gonna break this text down. I'm going home. Y'all with me? Where my pointer's at? You with me, pointer? Point one. Point one. Let's get to point one. The wise men. Point one is the wise men. Therefore, whosoever hear these sayings of mine. Who y'all think talking right here? Jesus. Y'all heard him? He talking. Right? He ain't talking to Baptists. He ain't talking to Protestant. He not talking to Catholic. He not talking to non-denominational. He talking to whosoever will hear these sayings of mine. You can be a sinner riding in your car right now. Listen to this. Smoking weed, drinking liquor, getting high on Hennessy. But if you hear the voice of the Lord, you can be doing whatever. I remember when I was a teenager, me and my friend were riding down the road, but mama had put God in me. I won't where I should have been, won't doing what I should have been doing, but I heard the word of God. My friend might have been rolling up a joint. We might have been puff past, but when the radio was on, and I heard the voice of the Lord, it's something about Jesus. I don't care how high you get, I don't care how drunk you get, your mind can focus in that you can hear. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house. Therefore, whosoever hear these sayings of mine and do them. This is Jesus talking. I will liken unto a wise man. You're not wise because you go to a Catholic church. You're not wise because you go to Church of God in Christ. You're not wise because you go to a Baptist church or a non-denomination or whatever religion, Kingdom Hall, Jehovah's Witness. I don't want to leave nobody out. If I left your name out, then stick it in there.
Yeah, I know that's right.
Because the Bible is not talking to no religion. He's not talking to no denomination. He's not talking to save or unsaved. He said, whosoever, therefore, hear these sayings of mine and doeth them. That's the problem with us now. We come to church. We're thinking that we so holy.
Amen.
That we so saved.
Oh, yeah.
that God only hears talks to us. He talked to the sinner. Because I once was lost in a world of sin. Far from the distant shore. Verily, deeply, I was stained within. Never to rise no more. But the Master, he didn't say, John, you're not a Baptist, you're not a Catholic, you're not a Protestant, you're not Church of God in Christ. But where I was at, the Master hearing my cry.
Yes, hallelujah.
And he came and he rescued me. He said, whoever doeth these things, I will liken unto him, unto a wise man who built his house upon a rock. Stop right there at point one.
Amen.
He said, built the house upon a rock. What he's trying to tell us, anybody know who the rock is?
Jesus.
Jesus is the rock.
Yes.
A lot of times we think building your Christianity on the rock, we thinking we building on the foundation. I'm building it on good stuff. I'm building it on truth. I'm building it on me being a good person. I'm building it on the church I go to. I'm building it on the tithes I pay. I'm building it on the prayer. You got to build your faith and hope on Jesus. He's the rock of our salvation. Amen. He's the rock. Amen. So build your foundation. Build your salvation upon Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. See right there it says build. To build means you got to start working.
Amen.
You can't sit to build.
Amen.
If you're going to build, you got to work.
Yes.
You know, build means to love your neighbor.
Yes.
Build means to, when you encounter people that may not be where they supposed to be,
right.
May not, they going through a trial, but you saved.
Yes.
And you know Jesus.
Yes.
Why don't we grab them and say, do you mind if I pray with you?
Come on. Yeah.
Amen.
That's building.
Yes.
That's introducing them to the rock.
Yes.
Amen. See, a lot of times we think because we come to church, is what we do in here.
No.
Y'all remember me preaching a sermon about the two brothers?
Mm-hmm.
One who left home,
yes.
Prodigal sons.
Yes.
But it was another brother who stayed at home.
Mm-hmm.
He never left his dad, he stayed.
Yes.
But he was more lost than the brother who left and came to himself and came back home. His father said, here's my son who was lost, but now he's found.
Amen.
He was blind.
Now you see.
But now he see.
Amen.
But when the old servant sent for the other brother to let him know that your brother was lost, he's coming back.
Right.
He won't happy.
Yes.
I feel like preaching, y'all, because sometimes in here we like that in the church.
Yes.
Folk leave the church because they weren't in their right mind or they didn't see it at that moment like we see it
right.
or like we think we see it.
Right.
But when folk come back home,
yes.
Folk come back to the church
yes.
after being gone for a little while.
Yes.
We ought to treat them more happier than they did when they left.
Amen.
We ought to be glad to see them.
Yes.
We ought to hug them.
Yes.
Let them know that we thank God that while you was out there, you could have failed into dangerous temptation.
Yes.
You could have fell on some stony thorns and could have been killed, but God allowed you to make it back.
Amen.
And so we should be glad to see him.
Yes.
The brother wasn't happy to see his brother.
No,
so that word is trying to tell us, a lot of us think because we in the church,
uh-huh.
we build.
Uh-huh.
The brother was there, but he was lost.
Amen.
God doesn't mind that you come to church every Sunday, but if you ain't building nothing,
right.
if you're not doing a self-examination,
right.
if you're coming to the church every Sunday, but you ain't changing, you're not, you're doing the same thing from Sunday to Sunday. You ain't loving your neighbors as you should love yourself.
Amen.
You're not treating everybody right. I ain't say some people. I didn't say the folk that you like, the people that you wave to every day. No, but you're not dealing with that challenge. See, a lot of us don't like rejection.
Amen.
We don't like going up to somebody and say, I'm sorry for the way I treated you, because they might roll their eyes or act like, you know, I don't care about you apologizing to me because I'm not apologizing to you. That's on them.
That's on them.
God would allow us to get in situations because he want to break you.
Amen.
to make you. Every now and then he allowed things to happen to see if you still got that old timey way. You still got that old spirit. You know, you might be in a situation where you're doing a good thing. And then somebody come to you and say something and get you all in your flesh. Now you mad. I ain't coming back to the church. We always blaming everybody but ourselves. You know, we don't look at us. God wants you to be a light. In a dark world. He said, what good is it a light that you threw on hide on a bushel? That can he wants you to be the light of the world. That he wants you to shine. That means wherever God place you, you ought to be a shining light. You ought to be a light in the church. God want to put you in a church where everybody in there raising hell. Everybody in there done lost their mind. But that's why he sent you. He didn't send you to a right church. He sent you to a church that need a light. You ought to be the light. You ought to come into the church and let your light so shine. You ought to show love. You ought to show joy. You ought to show peace. You ought to learn to tell people. It ain't good to gossip. It ain't good to talk about folk. You ought to stand for righteousness. Stand for goodness. Stand for kindness. No, but we are coming to church every Sunday. We're getting up every day. God letting us live every month. Letting us live every year. Day to day, month to month, year to year. And guess what? All you're doing is making shade. Where's your fruit? Where's your fruit? What are you building on? Huh? What are you building on? Are you building on Christ, the solid rock I stand? All things around me sink and sand. We ought to be building on Christ. We ought to be building on our attitude. Yes. Come on, Pastor Porter. Yes. You're talking to me. Build on our attitudes. You got to learn. See, I know we all striving. I'm not knocking y'all. I'm not in here beating you up. I'm preaching the word. Yes. We got to be striving every day to work on ourselves. Amen. Yes. You got to, in order to work on yourself, you got to know yourself. Amen. You got to know that you when people see you, they know you. Why do we always act like we don't know who we are? Hellraiser. Acting like, it ain't me. Yes, it is. It's you. You the hellraiser. Always starting stuff. Always got junk going on. It's you. Yeah. I would point four fingers, but I ain't got but one. I would point all four. You. Yeah, it's you. Right, yeah, we come to church, we ain't trying to change. God want us to change. He wants us to change our walk. What does that mean, Pastor? Change your walk. That means every time you take a step in whatever direction, you ought to be taking it for the glory of God. You got to. God don't want you to go from place to place causing trouble. He wants you to change your walk, right? If you go from this place to that place, you ought to be bringing something good. Yeah, you ought to be. You people should see you, and you ought to be the life of the party. A couple weeks ago, I was over at my son-in-law's house. Grandparents' house, and we was out there throwing bean bags, right? They called me. I sit there for about an hour or two, and I ain't do nothing. But everybody there knew that I was Bishop Porter. Yes. So they were smoking their weed, drinking their liquor, doing whatever. I'm not knocking them. Right. I'm not knocking them because I've smoked weed and I've drank. Amen. And glory be to God, I'm saved today. Amen. I don't know why we get saved. We think all of a sudden we so righteous. Amen. We think we better than everybody. I've done the things that they're doing, right? And I'm quite sure when I was doing them, somebody saw me that was saved, and they probably thought the same thing. Look at him. Right? But they might not know I got it right. Amen. Should I say he got it right? Because I can't do nothing without Christ. Amen. But the thing I'm saying is I was throwing these bean bags. And I wanted to go up there because the guy that was playing, he was beating everybody. He had beat probably about 10 people. See, I made a mistake because when I got up, I said to somebody, let me go up there and set him down because he beating everybody. And so I thought God was going to go with me. I thought God was going to show me and give me the spirit to set him down because he was doing too much, talking smack to everybody. But I lost. But I learned something. When I lost, I shook hands with people.
That's right.
I said, man, congratulations, good game. I walked all the way down to the other young man. I shook his hand, right? Not me, the God that's in me. Then I went and sat down because I wanted God to be pleased because, see, what God wanted me to show the people, you put to be a light. So when you lose, you don't put to get mad. Let's play another one. No, let's play another one. I could have showed out there. Could have made a complete fool out of myself. Could have made folk look at me and say, he a pastor? But when I lost, God wanted this. He wanted to see something in me. He wanted to see self-examination. He wanted to see, did I have humility? He wanted to see, have I been working on my soul salvation? Because when you're in the flesh, you might say or do anything.
That's right.
But when you're in the spirit, you can hear God.
Yeah.
And so when I did it, not willful or knowledgeable what I was doing, I just did what I felt was right.
Amen.
And then I went and sat down.
Yes.
And I heard the spirit of God letting me know. See, it's not about winning.
It's
how you play the game.
Amen.
That young man may have had a change of heart by the way I shook his hand, because I noticed something after I lost to him and I shook his hand, right? What I did notice is that he kind of came down a little bit.
All right.
He won't screaming at people, I'm the best, y'all can't beat me.
Right.
He ain't do none of that no more.
Right.
He just played.
Yes, amen.
Other thing I did, I'm not bragging God did it, because I knew it was Lord, it was God. They would throw the bean bags down on our end, right? Me and him worked together. We were on the same team. I would pick up blue and orange, he would pick up blue and orange, and he would give them to me, and I would give to him. I think a lot of it because he respected me as a pastor. But he worked with me.
Yes.
And I noticed with other people, they had to go find their bags, and he might be right there or whoever. But we as Christians, we supposed to be the light of the world.
Amen.
We supposed to walk around day to day being a help to other people.
That's
I'm not ashamed of this.
No.
Yesterday, I helped a young man. I was at my job walking. A young man walked up to me and said he wanted something to eat. Tuck him to get something to eat. This morning, I pulled up with my son off the interstate. Another man was standing there with a sign, needed something to eat. So I went where I should have been. Because in my mind, I said, well, I helped somebody yesterday.
Yeah.
I'm not going to help this guy. Somebody else will help him.
That's
right. So I sit there at the light. It was red for about 2 minutes. Thank God for my son.
Yeah.
Always keep people around you to save that
That's
will help
right.
you when, you
right.
are, when you're not where you're supposed
That's
to be.
Right, That's right.
So my son said, Dad, you got any spare change money on you? Because I ain't got big money. He said, that man needs some help. Now, God had already ministered to me about that man.
No.
When I pulled up,
uh-huh.
Are you going to help him? Well, I helped the guy yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But when my son said it, I rolled the window down.
Mm-hmm.
I went in my pocket, and I took out some money that I had, and I gave it to him. He came over. He was grateful.
Yeah.
The light turned green. So I'm showing y'all how the devil worked. The light turned green, and he was trying to come to me, and the enemy was saying, the light green, catch him next time, pull off. But I waited.
Yes, amen.
Right? Now, it may seem like I'm bragging on me, but I'm not. Because I'm telling you, when I pulled up, I wasn't going to give this man money. The light turned green. The enemy was already in my mind telling me to pull off, catch up to him next time. Folk will start blowing. Right? But one thing I'm still learning is I had somebody beside me.
Yes.
That's why God told us we need to go out by twos.
Yes.
Stop going out here in the world by yourself trying to do everything by yourself, because the enemy will get you and he'll catch you up.
Yes.
But when you got somebody beside you, with my son being there, he was standing there looking at me. Like I tell you, they're watching you. He was going to say, let me see if Dad going to give him, because he helped the other man. Was he going to help him? He might have been, I ain't saying he's saying this, he might have been sitting there, see if dad gonna pull off or he gonna stay and wait. Uh-huh. See, but by him being there, yeah. He held me responsible.
Amen. I'm talking to somebody. Amen. Yes.
Sometimes by us, being there, or having other people in our life, when you hang around your wife, your husband, your children, your best friend, somebody that's saved, you need to have saved folk around you. Because when you got saved folk around you, they'll keep you out of trouble.
Amen.
Amen.
I know that's
point two. And everyone that hears these sayings of mine, this is Jesus still talking, and doeth them not, shall be likened unto a foolish man. Well, built his house on the sand. Wise man built his house on a rock, which is Jesus.
Yes.
Foolish man builds his house on a sand.
Amen.
Sand gives way.
Amen.
Sand doesn't stand. It says then the rain. Listen to God. He's talking to us because we're about to go home. He says when you build your house on a rock or on sand, both of these incidents say the same thing. They're right there in your book. Read them.
Amen.
They both say the same thing. They saying that if you save,
yes.
Right, there it is. Rain descended on the saved.
Yes.
Rain descended on the foolish.
Yes.
Rain descended on the wise man. Rain descended on the foolish.
Yes.
Floods came upon the wise man.
Yes.
Floods came
on
the foolish.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. See, there it is right here.
Mm-hmm.
Winds blew.
Yes.
Blew up against the house of the wise man, and the winds blew up against the house of the foolish.
Yes.
And they beat upon that house.
Yes.
Well, God wants us to understand in all of our lives, if you're wise or if you're foolish, you're going to go through the same trials and tribulations. I want you to know today, just because you saved don't mean that you exempt from trouble.
Amen.
Just because you're not saved does not mean you're not exempt from trouble. But what we want you to know today is that if you're going to go through some trouble, you better have Jesus with you. Because Satan will set us up. He'll have you out there thinking that you can, you will be all right. You're going to make it through. A lot of us don't turn to Jesus until it gets so bad that we don't have no choice. But he talks about something else as I get ready to close. And I get ready to leave you alone. The point one, we talked about the wise man.
Yes.
Spent a lot of in-depth time about him. And point two, we talked about the foolish man. Basically does just the opposite of what the wise man did, right? But it says here that the wise man experienced something. It says, and it fell not.
Yes.
Meaning that the Bible said that we're going to go through things, right? Trials and tribulations are going to come,
yes, they are.
Right? And we're going to go through things. But God is saying right here, just as Jesus talking, he said, and it fell not. He's saying to the wise man, when he went through and everything that happened to him, the house still stood. It didn't fall.
Yes.
But if you go down here to the foolish man, it says, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. When you got your life right with God,
come on, Pastor.
Save or not, we're going to go through.
Yes, we will.
Amen.
Flood's going to come.
Yes.
Rain going to beat.
Yes.
We're going to go through the same thing. You're going to lose things. Save, you're going to lose things. Unsaved.
Amen.
That's right.
But he says at the end, if you have problems and you got to go to court, when you go to court, Jesus is telling you, don't worry about it. I got you.
Okay.
No matter what you go through, it's going to work out.
Yeah.
Elder Reed came to us last week, told us he had to go take care of some things. She came back and said, Pastor, it's all good.
It's all good.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And I looked at it, I said to myself as I walked down the hallway, down the steps, I said, it's got to be good. You saved. Amen. God got you.
Amen.
He said, weapons,
no weapons
shall form, but they will not. Come on now. Things going to happen to all of us.
Amen.
Same way it was happening to her, it was happening to me. It happened to her, it's happening. You know, your children are going to go out and they're going to make a mistake. They're going to fall short of what you, sometimes they worry you to death. You feel like, you just feel like, you know, what is wrong with this child? Look in the mirror. Your mama probably said the same thing about you. What is wrong with this child? Yeah, it's just a cycle. Just repeat itself. You know, your mom, she didn't give up on you. Your dad didn't give up on you. You can't give up. You got to just hang in there, because one day when you least expect it, you know.
Amen.
They gonna come to their own. There was a saying when I was a child young man had went to his mother. She had been there for him through all the struggles of his life, things he had been through that he had disappointed her. It broke her heart. When he finally made it, he was playing basketball. He finally made it. Really, it was Isaiah Thomas. It was an Isaiah Thomas story.
Amen.
And he grew up poor, really didn't have a lot. And he watched his mom. He had like maybe 10 children in the home. She trying to feed all of them. The father had left. And she had to stand there and raise her kids by herself. And in this story, when they got down to the end, they told you all the poverty, and Isaiah grew up in the area he grew up in, and they had gangs, and they were trying to recruit him.
Yes.
His older brother had become caught up in drugs. He was out there on the corner. Mother would walk by, her son laying on the corner, doped up, drugged up. She would come in the house, and she would cry. He would say, Mama, what you crying for? I said, I just saw your older brother. He laying out there on the streets. He's just doped up. She said, I've done all I can to raise these children. But in this story, I love this part when it got to the end. And Isaiah was going to college, and he was playing basketball. He was doing good, and he ended up getting, he had to take a test.
Amen.
He was not the most smartest kid in the class. Mm-hmm. And he really didn't understand, and he had to take this test, and he was like, Mama, I'm not going to school because the kids laugh at me because I can't read too good. And he said, I'm good in basketball, but I'm not good in books.
Yes.
So when he got down to this thing, his mother brought him in the room. And she told him, she said, that poem that you're reading, that don't fit you. She said, I want you to read a poem that my daddy gave me. And it was about the man that stood, and he was mobbed and all these different things. It was a strong poem, you know. But Isaiah felt the poem. And she kept working with him in her room. It was late at night. And she kept telling him, she said, read it again. And he would read it again. And he was like, you know, Mom, it just don't fit. She said, listen, close your eyes. She said, now say it. Because they wanted him to say the poem without reading it. She said, you got to feel it in your heart.
Yes.
I'm about to close. She said, you got to feel it in your heart, son. So Isaiah started looking at all that his mother had been through and all that the family had been through. And it talked about the man that had been mobbed and had beaten and, you know, but he had to still stand.
Yes.
And so he started reading the poem, and he felt it because he saw his brother.
Yes.
He saw his mother struggling. And he began to read this poem. So the next day he got up, he went to school, stood outside the classroom, took 2-3 breaths. He was scared.
Yes.
But he had to face his fears.
Yes.
He walked into the classroom. The kids were laughing. His classroom was all white. He was the only black kid in the school. The reason why they had him in that school, because he could play basketball. He was very good.
Uh-huh.
He was the leading scorer of the school. But in this, he had to get past this, because if he didn't pass this, he was going to fail.
Yes.
The coach was rooting for him, everybody.
Uh-huh.
He got up in front of the class, he read the poem, standing ovation.
Amen.
he read it the first time, he messed it up. Kids started to get ready to laugh. He looked at the teacher, he said, "You mind if I try it again?" She said, "Go ahead and try it again." He closed his eyes, he heard his mama saying, "It's in your heart." He closed his eyes, she said, "Just read it from your heart." He closed his eyes, he took a deep breath and began to quote the poem. He read it. He opened up his eyes when he finished, and he cleared all the kids standing ovation.
Yeah,
right? So the moral to the story, the next whatever end of the school year, they brought him up for graduation. Of course, you know he was an athlete of the year. When they brought him up for graduation, and he stood up, he wasn't the valedictorian, he wasn't the smartest person in class. They allowed the valedictorian to speak, and they wanted him to speak because he was the athlete of the year. He had broke the school records. So they brought him up. His mother was there. And all his brothers and sisters were sitting on the row. Holes in their stockings, raggedy looking dresses. Mom was sitting there best she could with her family. And he stood in front of his mother, in front of this whole school with about 98% was Caucasian. And he said something to his mother in front of the school. They were all other people, other kids that came before him, they talked about their heroes. My hero is this person. He stood there, he said, "My hero is a person who not well educated. She don't always do everything to please everybody." He said, "But my hero is a person who keep this family together."
Amen.
My hero was a person that she didn't score all the baskets. She was the person that when we were down, she knew how to get my attention, me and my brothers and sisters. And she kept us together as a family. And then he said something, as I'm getting ready to take my seat. He said to his mother, he looked in her face. He said, "Mama, I want to thank you for taking me, taking us to the top of the mountain."
Amen.
And he said, "Mama, when I got there and I looked over, it was some kind of view." He said, "Thank you for getting us there." And then there was a standing ovation. And as I thought about this sermon, I thought about Isaiah Thomas' life. His mother was a light in a dark world. They lived in the projects, gangs, guns, violence, shooting. But his mom didn't run. She stood and raised her kids, and she educated them, and she helped them to get through things. And that day she was sitting there, tears in her eyes flowing down her face, as her son stood in front of the school and gave his speech.
Amen.
And he told his mama, he said, "I was afraid to stand in front of people." He said, "But it was because of that poem and my mom, and she put in me to not be afraid to face your fears."
Amen.
"She taught me to deal with things that come and realize you're not gonna win every battle, but don't run from nothing."
Amen.
And so today, as I leave y'all, I say that to you today. God knows our heart. God knows we're not gonna cross every T, and nor are we gonna dot every I.
Amen.
But he wants you to be a light in a dark world.
Amen.
Whatever you go through in this world, you have to be the light in your family, in your community, on your job, in your own self.
Amen.
Be the light. Don't look for other people to do it. You do it.
Amen.
Don't look for other people in the neighborhood to make the neighborhood great. You make it great.
Amen.
Don't look for everybody on your job to make the job great. You make it great. Don't look for people in your home to be the first one to make it, to hold everything together. There's been times in my life as a husband, as a dad, as a person, I wasn't always there to just hold it together. Sometimes she had to.
Yes.
Amen. But at the end of the day, we had to always understand we were a family. Right? And a family means that. That all it, you're not gonna always get it right. But when you really love folk and you really in a family, a community family, a family that in your home, a family on your job, a family in your church, you're not gonna always get it right. But family stay together,
yes.
Pray together,
yes.
Love together, and at the end of the day, we can do all things through Christ if we work together. God bless you, and heaven smile upon you. Sean, give me that right there, and we going home, bro. Give me that little light of mine. We're going to let it shine one more Sunday. We got to let this light shine. God is dealing with us about light. Amen. We going home, church. But we want to play this little light of mine. Because I want you to sit there and think about you. God is what people tell you. You are light.
Amen.
Stop letting folk validate your self-work.
Amen.
Don't let people tell you negative things. You dish, you that, you dish. You are a light. And be that light. Turn it up a little bit.
Down, Lord.
Burns 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 down, Lord.
Star.
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 Star.